Hello and welcome to our conversation about nature's rhythms, silence, and the human relationship to the environment, art, deep cold, and more with Will Steger and Erling Kagge. I'm Kate Nordstrom, the executive and artistic director of the Great Northern. Every year, our festival shares dozens of performances, art installations, outdoor activations, and solutions-focused climate talks during the last week of January and the first week of February that invigorate the mind and the body. We want to thank the many organizations and individuals that contribute to our festival annually. And if you would like to support our ability to bring you this free programming, please consider making a donation on our website, thegreatnorthernfestival.com. I'm joining you from Minneapolis, Minnesota, the indigenous land of the Dakota and Anishinaabe people. And I would like to invite you to introduce yourself in the chat, sharing who you are. And if you know the native lands that you live on, you can share that too. We are honored to be in conversation today with Will and Erling about their explorer mindsets. Erling Kagge is a polar explorer, mountaineer, publisher, author, an inspired art collector. He was the first to walk the South Pole alone, the first to walk the North Pole unsupported with Borge Olen, the first to reach the North Pole, South Pole, and summit of Everest on foot. He has sailed across the Atlantic and around Cape Horn to Antarctica and crossed New York City alpine style through its train, subway, water, and sewage tunnels with Steve Duncan. Will Steger, a formidable voice calling for understanding and the preservation of the Arctic and the Earth, is best known for his legendary polar explorations. He has traveled tens of thousands of miles by kayak and dog sled over 50 years, setting records and leading teams on some of the most significant polar expeditions in history. He is an author, an educator, entrepreneur, founder of Climate Generation, and a Minnesota treasure. Welcome.
Hi there.
Hey, Erling, how are you doing?
I'm doing really well. I'm super happy to see you and also everybody who's watching Will and me. It's a great privilege to be invited to this on this occasion. And I'm sitting here in Oslo in my office at home. And I so much look forward to talking to you, Will, because you was my hero in the 80s when you started looking to walking to the North Pole.
Yeah, Erling and I have something in common. You did the unsupported by skis from the pole to North Pole in 1990, and then I did it. Most Minnesotans know me as a dog sled unsupported in 1986. So we shared our same experience on the Arctic Ocean. And we met once in Norway, but I always wanted to talk with you. And Borge, your partner on that 1990 expedition, is a good friend of mine. And maybe I'd like to start off maybe about describing the Arctic Ocean. I have a couple of questions for you. How is the ice when you traveled about 480 miles? The Arctic Ocean is a moving ice. Back then in 1990, it's totally changed now. And but what was your ice like, and what was your temperatures like when you first started?
When we landed on the 8th of March 1990 on the northern tip of Ellesmere Island, the temperature was minus 52 on the airplane, and I guess it kept around minus 50, minus 45, minus 40 for quite a few weeks until it slowly started to heat up with the sun rising, eventually the midnight sun. But we were so focused on getting to the pole and save weight and not bring any extra. So we actually didn't bring a thermometer. So the only measure we have in terms of temperature was the airplane minus 52 centigrade. And yeah. I remember flying above the northern tip of Ellesmere Island, saw these open leads, and this bush pilot had been flying up in the Arctic for 15 years, So the last thing he said to us after having seen the ice, he said, I see you guys back again in 4 days. But we were super determined, of course, not to give up. So ice was rough, but you know, if the ice isn't rough and if it isn't super cold, then everyone can walk to the North Pole. And I guess for you too, Will, one of the reasons for walking to the North Pole, it is because it's difficult.
Yeah. It was, you know, we did it with Sexton only. We didn't have the GPS and the systems at that time, which was really, really iffy. We were out of food when we reached the pole, probably same with yourself. And but it was a cold year. We had 72 below Fahrenheit. We had a thermometer, so 72 below zero when we started Fahrenheit, and it was 60 below for the first week. And but in 86 at least, it was an old fashioned cold. You know, back in the day before the changes, so it was super cold. We had some open water. You know, it was very challenging. 95, I crossed it. From the Russia to the pole down, and 95 years later, we had more open water in one day than we did in 86. And hey, just the last question I have for you: how was your ice in 1990? Was it pretty frozen, or did you see any climate change coming on? Was it unusually open?
No, it was not unusually open. I think we had a kind of a normal year. Berge, my partner, obviously has walked to the North Pole quite a few times afterwards, and he said probably slightly more rough ice, a little bit more up and downs, more ice ridges than normal. But in general, I think it was a normal year. And at that time, we didn't really experience anything that could be a sure sign of any climate change. And
you know, I've been waiting for about 30 years to have this conversation with you. You know, we met briefly in Norway, and the audience, you know, there's 20 people in my life that I have something in common as an explorer, and you're one of them. I mean, anyone that's done the unsupported and the expeditions you have. So it's really interesting to have something in common and like-minded. And why don't we talk a little bit more why we do it, and maybe get into depth in something rather than the usual, you know, adventure talk, hardships and that. But what motivates?
I think, you know, first of all, I'm happy you feel you have something to common with me in this respect. But I think, you know, we also have something in common, the two of us, and probably everybody who's watching it right now, and with most people. And that is that we are all born explorers. So we quite often ask, you know, when did you become an explorer? But I think, you know, everyone who's born is an explorer, in the sense that I have three kids, and every kid of my three kids being born, the first instinct they had was to stretch out their arms and their legs and shout out for more air, more space, and just feel the world around them, and being relieved, getting out of the stomach, and of course soon to have some food. So I think that's a basic instinct we're all born with. We would like to have more space around ourselves. And the second instinct I saw was after a year to learn how to walk. And the first thing they did, like most kids, walked out of the house, into the garden, and started to wonder what was between themselves and the horizon, and soon beyond the horizon. So I think those two instincts, something we all have, it never goes away. But obviously for you and me and some other explorers, this spirit of exploration is still very strong. So I think, you know, it's a natural, you know, we're kind of all born North Pole explorers, I think.
Yeah, very well put.
And I also think it's like, you know, we talked with email a little bit about it, Will, and I think it's like, I think it genuinely is important to try to make your life more difficult than it has to be, to make life meaningful. And for me, that has been a kind of a key. I grew up in nature, close to nature. I was skiing every winter. In my family, my father said, downhill skiing, TV, cars, all diseases that will eventually destroy society. And you know, I think in terms of TV and cars, it was partly right. And so we were very much an outdoor family. And I went skiing, as I said, and I just want to keep on exploring. I want to be close to nature. I wanted to feel the cold, the wind, the snow, etc. And you, Will?
It's hard to explain why you do this, and most people get hung up in the hardship of it all. And the hardships are actually physical hardships, as long as it's not life and limb threatening, is just part of the dues you have to pay to see the incredible beauty of the far north in that colder area. But to me, it's about the silence. It's about seeing it's all about, my life has always been about inspiration and beauty. And I've been chasing that inspiration all my life. But in the polar regions and the Arctic regions, you know, it's cold and so forth. You have to have skills. And it is tough sometimes. You're short on food and that. That's not the end of the world, though. But I've always sought out challenges like that. I started out climbing as a younger person. And I think most people have a tendency of seeking comfort and security, which is fine. But by really pushing yourself, and again, like we talked about before, it doesn't necessarily, not everybody's a polar explorer, but we're all different. We all explore with our imagination in different ways. But we really have to, to get the most out of life, and especially to find your purpose and empower yourself, you have to go beyond a little bit, beyond that comfort zone and challenge things a little bit. And so on that edge is where you really find the exploration. You learn about yourself. It's kind of hard to learn about yourself when everything is secure and you're entertaining yourself all your life. And not saying anything about entertainment, but doing it all the time and using that as your sort of your escape. I don't know what people are escaping from, everything we're self-contained, we're spiritually self-contained. Everything that is within us is what we have. We don't have to look outside. It's been chasing materialism is the problem. I mean, this is why we have climate change, and this is why we're losing the environment, and why our animals and plants are going extinct, is that we're insatiated with materialism and owning things and this desire to seek outside of ourselves constantly for something that's going to satisfy us. And we all know that when you buy that thing you want, you then 5 minutes later, a month later, you're looking for something else. It's a treadmill. Whereas for myself, it's been my expedition's like a mobile Zen monastery. The silence in the wilderness to me is music. It's just beautiful. I don't need music in the wilderness, but it's within that silence of calming your mind down. So you're seeing, you're observing, you're not judging, and you're not pushing it, but you're just there as an observer. That's my main reason why I travel like that, is to really see the world. And I come back energized and inspired. And I'm sure you felt in many different ways the same thing.
Yeah, I think what you just said also, though, just now, with getting to know yourself, I think exploration is very much about that. And of course, that's one of the oldest advices in the history, is to get to know yourself. And I think every advice that have survived for more than 2,000 years, we should take really seriously. And to get to know yourself, you have to do uncomfortable things, as I said. You have to challenge yourself in different ways. And as I also started out to say, which is very agreeing with what you said, Will, is this importance of making life more difficult. And of course, George Mallory said the famous, like, why do you have to climb Everest? He said, it's because it's there. I think it was a very clever answer, because the way I interpreted that answer is that it's very few things in life you actually have to do. You hardly have to do anything. If your mother is nice to you, you can even stay in bed all day and she will eventually give you something to eat. So I think it all degrees from we wake up in the morning to the day. You have all these options about easy choices, more difficult choices. And my experience is choose the most difficult option as often as possible. And of course, walking to the North Pole is very much about making your life more complicated, to suffer more, to starve, to freeze, lack of sleep. But all this, of course, is painful. But the beauty is that you get closer to yourself. You're starting to understand who you are, getting closer to the nature. And you also live a life where the distance between what you feel like being hell and what being heaven or paradise is very short. So you get all these variations in your emotions and pleasure and pain. And this again makes life super rich. And in my experience, like, you know, I'm 60 years old and I meet all these people who say, life is so short, time passed by so fast, and all these days, weeks, years passed by, and I didn't really understand this was life. But I think if you are an explorer and you relate to nature, life is not short, then life is long.
Yeah, yeah. So you wrote a book on silence that I really liked. And can you talk a little bit about what silence is for you?
I had three teenage daughters, and of course, exploration for me is very much about silence. But when I got daughters in the house and they became teenagers, and I had a job to be able to buy a house and live a kind of civilized life with my family, my life was all about noise. And one day I was sitting having Sunday dinner with my daughters, and they tried to act like they didn't check their phones all the time. And I tried to explain them about silence and why silence is important. And they just looked at me and thought I was stupid. Because I said, silence, why silence? Silence is nothing. And it's quite a common idea to think about silence as nothing. Even if you study philosophy, you know, one of the first things you read and learn is that nothing comes from nothing. And so very few philosophers have been writing about silence too. So after that dinner, I start to wonder, how could I tell about the importance of silence, about what is silence, and where is silence, and why is it important? So those three questions, I sat down, I used a year and a half to come up with 33 answers to those three questions. And to my great surprise, the book became a bestseller. It was a surprise because when I wrote the book, book agents, etc., were not interested at all in what I was doing. But suddenly something hit the zeitgeist and people wanted to read it. And my three daughters read it. And the two oldest really appreciated the text about what silence is, and their friends read it. While my youngest daughter, who was 15 at the time, she read parts of it and threw it away. I thought it was absolutely bullshit. I think in general, I think 15-year-old girls are probably the most unhappy group on Earth.
Well, yeah, I wouldn't know, so I didn't raise any daughters.
That's my experience as a father.
Yeah. So let's talk about the climate a little bit. I mean, you know, we both have seen, of course, we've been eyewitness to what's happened. So we know it more than textbook. We know it intuitively because we've been on the ice when it's, you know, disintegrated. And now I think the rest of the world is starting to see climate. So we're all eyewitnesses now. But I struggle with right at this point, you know, what do you say to people about the climate? I mean, I didn't know if I would be alive when this happened, when we realized, I think within the last year, that the climate is out of control and there's no fixing it. We have to adapt to it. There are solutions. But how do you couch that? Because I'm used to challenges or anything. We're used to everything that has solutions. So if you want to look in the, you know, if you were talking with people, you talk about solutions. And if you look, I can do this, I can do that. There's solutions. I feel good, so I can go get on with my life. But now there is a very difficult, you know, situation. It's for sure not the end of the world. I mean, most people are looking at the end of the world. I mean, we'll adapt to this, and human species is, we're more adaptable than any species on the planet. And we've adapted before, and we may not have the same world as we have today 100 years from now, but there's still going to be, you know, the possibilities of, if we don't, you know, nuke ourselves, there's going to be the possibility of, you know, a good life still. And it's kind of, we're at a fork actually in the road, that we have two choices. We can go on the way we're doing, we've lived and so forth. That's not working, but there's a new path forward, which is actually a very high quality life. I figure I live very simple. I mean, when I'm not in the city working on projects, I live in the wilderness, and I get my wash water from a rain barrel, and I've done that for the last 55 years. I mean, I purposely sought out an extremely simple life, which to me is a really, really high quality life. Not saying that everybody's got to have a wash and a rain barrel, but it's the simplicity. We have to look, you know, down the line that it's going to be a simpler. And I actually look at Norway a lot, that in Scandinavia countries where things are a little simpler than the United States, but it's really, really high quality. But how do you look at the climate? How do you, first of all, for yourself, and what would you say to the audience that listening today? What should we do? What are the 10 things I can do? How would you answer that?
You know, first of all, living in Norway, we have one challenge less than you, because I think in general in Norway, everybody's convinced climate change is happening. So while in the States, sometimes you have a discussion if it's a climate change, what's going on. Almost every Norwegian is convinced or has understood that the temperature is rising. So, and also to what you said, to have a simpler lifestyle, I think one of the best advices ever is, if you're going to have a happy life, keep your pleasure simple. So I think that's also something we learn when we're on expeditions, the great pleasure of the simple life. In Norway, like I think almost every country in the world, we're obviously not doing enough. It's really difficult to get people inspired to change their lives. But my feeling is, just the last year, 2 years, 3 years, people have started to take it more and more seriously. So change is happening in Norway and major parts of Europe just now. But of course, at the same time, Norway is rich for several reasons. And one of the main reasons is because we are oil-rich nation. So there are many paradoxes in this. And as I said, it's not one great solution. However, I have to say, because everybody is so pessimistic, I'm happy when you also, you know, from what you said, that we shouldn't be total pessimists, because I think it's important today also to be optimistic. We can still be realistic and still have some optimism within us, not like being stupid, naively optimistic, but I think it's important to always keep in mind that almost every problem is possible to solve somehow, maybe not today, but hopefully in the future. So that's not an argument against changing our lifestyle, but this idea that the world almost will go under within 10 years, I think is wrong, but I also think it's hurting the case because the situation is super grave, and we don't need slogans like, you know, within 10 years this will happen, basta. Yeah, but you, Will, you have seen more of it than I have, because I'm fascinated by your life as an educator and also your life as committed to this, to this course. I have, as you said, I have spent time writing about silence, because to me it's definitely not more important than issues around climate, but silence was very close to my heart, and when I write something, I like to write something which is comes from my heart and also very personal, and different from what other people are writing. But in your case, you have really committed to tell people about what's going on in the world. And what do you think about, you know, what's happening in art, in the Arctic in particular, but also in the world in general?
Let's see here. I think my connection, I think, went low here. You know, I feel that we have a spiritual void right now. I think, you know, things are so crazy. I mean, it's politics, it's climate, it's everything. People are frantic, and the world's going to come to an end. And when you have a void, it's an opportunity to fill that void. So that's, and the human spirit, what I've seen in my life, you can't keep the human spirit down. I mean, you can keep it down for a while, but it'll always come back up. And I just feel the spirit is down a little low now, and we can be expected. We're going through some really major changes in the world. I mean, our advances in technology and our means of communication and the climate change. When I see them, when they visit me up northern Minnesota, you know, it's a very wild country. People see the night sky. I take the night sky almost for granted sometimes. I don't in the city, but we're out of touch with the reality, and we're out of touch with our nature, which we're all part of. And so I feel the solutions to climate change lie really within ourselves. You know, I could give you 10 things to do, change the light bulbs and that, but that's again being part of the problem. If you're not self-activated, if you really have a desire to know, you can do all that research yourself and join that whatever and talk with people. But you know, we have climate deniers. I know people get down on that in the United States. It's not as bad as you think. They're loud. There's maybe 20% of it, but really, so what? I mean, we're all entitled to our opinion. And to get down that, there's people denying it. When it's a belief system, it goes into a belief system. You know, you can believe in whatever you want, and that's a reality to you. So people have different realities. I think it's one thing when we have elected officials or people in leadership and business and that, they're denying that. And especially in business in the United States, you don't see that very much, because you're not going to have a market. No one's going to buy your stuff if you're denying climate, which is like, you know, a fourth grader gets that. But it's in the belief system, though, it's a different story. And then you're talking about pessimism. There's plenty of that around. And that's all all negative stuff. And the power is really the positive of, and you know the direction because you can feel it. When you get negative, you can feel yourself go down. And when you're positive and you know right from wrong, you don't have to read about it. You sense it, you know exactly where, if you follow your heart, you feel that and you got to follow that. And, you know, and being alone, like, is, you know, you've seen Erling too, you know, you've soloed, but then you're with a partner. But when you're with other people, you've got a tremendous amount of support. Like in Antarctica, we crossed with six people from six countries. And there were three times there we really thought we were going to perish when we lost three caches. But, and we said often that, you know, if we were one straw, we'd be blown over, but we're six, so we're going to survive this. So, to have friends and have a community that you surround yourself with the right people that support yourself, that's really where your power is. But I'm hopeful. I mean, I'm 78 years old, and I know we're going to see some big changes, but there are so many great opportunities, especially economic opportunities, because if climate didn't present us with economic opportunities, I would have packed it up 20 years ago. But the solution to climate change is economics. I mean, we're going to get rid of the carbon here by clean energy, and the way we build and the way we live, we're going to get it simpler. We're just passing a bill right now in Minnesota. It's 100% renewables electricity, and it's going to be signed probably next week. This is very positive stuff, but we're, as a state, guess what? Our electricity is all going to be clean. And so with the economics on our side, you have the ability to raise people out of poverty, which is, I mean, we have two major challenges. We have race and we have climate, and they really mingle in climate justice. And the way to bring people out of injustices, you have to have economy. I mean, you can do programs to help, but there's this huge future ahead. We cannot get enough workers, and it's always going to be that way as we make this incredible transition. We're going to take the money away from fossil fuels here, which we're doing in Minnesota, and we're going to employ our own people with it. So in our inner cities, where we have a blight here in Minnesota, real discrepancy in the inner city compared to the ring of outer suburbs around that, there's going to be lots of opportunity. And that's how I see it. I see an equitable and a just future for us with the economy, even in the Southern Hemisphere. And the people in the Southern Hemisphere didn't cause this problem, but they're going to feel it the most. But there's really opportunities there. We're overpopulated, way overpopulated. I don't have the solutions to that, but, you know, nature will figure it out. But those of us that are really privileged to be in the United States or Norway, we have a responsibility, and we got to take that responsibility on and not pass the buck down the line. And in taking on the responsibility, you empower yourself and you gather energy and you gather the spirit. And that's where how we're going to solve this. And we won't do it alone. We have to do it together. But we also have to accept that not everybody's always going to believe in what we believe in. And we have to respect other people. I think the problem we have right now is intolerance. But anyways, I got into it a little deep, but that's a little bit like what expeditions are about, though, because you think about these things on an expedition.
Suits you well. I strongly agree with what you said, that if you're going to change the society, it has to start with individuals. It's quite common to blame the politicians, and sometimes it's reasonable to blame the politicians, but if you want change, as many clever has said before me, you need to start with yourself. And I think, you know, what, you know, the way I understand it, Will, is that everybody can change the world. We can't change the whole world, any of us, but you can at least change small parts of the world. I think maybe the biggest mistake we're doing today, both in this perspective but also in general, is that we humans are more and more separating ourselves from nature. We have this idea that life can be lived in a rich way, mostly sitting in a chair or being inside most of the day. We do our physical exercise inside, we work inside, we eat and drink and live inside, and kind of forgetting nature, even thinking or concluding sometimes that we are more powerful than nature. So I think that's kind of a basic problem also in terms of climate change, but also in terms of living a good life. Because I think it's, if you're going to have a rich life, at least for most people, you need to experience the nature in a physical way, not only through a screen. And one of the reasons I think this is because Homo sapiens, we for 200,000 or 300,000 years, since we started to walk on two legs, we have always been exploring the world, understanding the world, and getting to know ourselves by doing something physical. It was not we who invented the possibility to walk on two legs, but the possibility to walk on two legs invented Homo sapiens. And we have always been walking, we have always been smelling, feeling the wind, the temperatures, tasting, touching, walking on, getting tired, sleep, walk on. This is what humans have been doing every generation until today. So today we are the first generations who think we can explore the world, understand what's going on around us, understand other people, understand who we are by looking into a screen. And here in Norway, I guess the numbers are about the same in Minnesota. Most people average 3.5-4 hours every day looking into a screen, not related to work, but just beyond work. And if you live until you are 82 or 84 years old, this will add up to 13 years of your life, day and night. And then again, of course, people get sad, lonely, feel hopelessness, and even get depressed if you live such a life. And also, it's hard to relate to what's going on, or at least more difficult to relate to what's going on with the climate or nature in general if you don't see it. And just like one example, that so many people in the world grow up today never seeing or hardly ever seeing the stars, looking into a starry heaven. And I think, you know, that's one of the best educations you can have, at least early in life, but also later, to be reminded about who you are and how you live by looking into the stars. And to me, that teaches you a great lesson about being humble, because you're just this little tiny part of the whole universe. But also teach a lesson, I think, about your own greatness, because after all, you are part of all of it, and it all depends on you, and you depends on everything. And I think that's a healthy view to the world.
Yep. Yeah, I like what you said about, you know, to get in nature does take a little bit of an effort. And I'm a good one for setting a rhythm. I mean, I set a rhythm on an expedition. I have a rhythm. I try to keep on a rhythm. And you need discipline, but you also need to party up a little bit. So you can't be a real stiff, but discipline is real. And getting into that rhythm. And part of that rhythm, you know, people walk their dog. I mean, that gets you outside. But you've got to, you know, just make that effort of getting out and getting, I mean, fresh air is everything to me. I mean, especially now in Minnesota, it's really nice and cold. And if you're skiing, if you're outside, you know, for an hour or two in this cold weather and you're moving, I'll guarantee your mood's going to be pretty good when you come inside. And then we're basically animals, we're human beings, and we need this rhythm and this breathing and this vitality. And we also, because we have to make a living, we've got to work 40 hours a week or whatever it is that we do. And a lot of that is sometimes joyful. Other times it's maybe not. But we still have to have that self-control. and getting into that rhythm is really is helpful. And it does take discipline. I mean, when I'm in the city, I've got a lot of demands. I have to raise money, meet a lot of people and so forth. So, and I don't necessarily, I mean, I take long walks maybe once a week, but I really mind to enough sleep, which takes discipline to go to bed. I mean, and I might have a drink once in a while, but not often. But it takes that, you know, it takes self-control to get your body tuned and going. So and the end product to me is also always inspiration, because if I'm in rhythm, I'm inspired, I'm happy, I see the world, I love people, I like being around, whatever I'm doing, I'm when I'm inspired. And then if I lose that inspiration, life becomes harder. But you have, you know, we have choices and we have ways of control over that to a large degree. I mean, part of your life you don't have any control of, but you have your, I've shaped my life and my world around me by my intention. We all have intention. That's the power. And that intention cannot be, maybe it's not used at all, or the intention could be, but it's really your intention of the direction that you're pointing your energy and your will, and in that direction. If you're living a life of intention, not that you're always intent and pushing, but you know, intention is something you forget about for maybe even a month or so, whatever. You don't think about it. It's your direction or the momentum of your spirit and your will. And if that's bound to your heart, which is goodness, you're going to do okay. You have the best chances. But, you know, accidents happen. You never have control over life. We're so delicate. But you do have huge control. And you run that by your your energy for us. So, and nature has just looked through a telescope. I must have been 8 years old. I saw the nebula of Orion and rings of Saturn. You know, I've been chasing that inspiration ever since. Yeah. This type of more nature. A lot of us live in an inner city. Or, you know, you'd always not all of us have the privilege of this ways. And Ben.
I think, you know, most of us live in cities, but you know, you start out asking me about silence. And of course, you and me, and I guess many other people who's listening, have experienced silence in nature and having the privilege, because you are very privileged if you experience silence in nature. But I think you talk about intention, etc. I think it's this inner silence which is the most important in life, because silence surrounding you is great. But to me, the opposite of noise is not no sounds. It, to me, the opposite is to find this inner silence where you can also remember your intentions and remember why it's some of the reasons with your life. And I think it's, you can always do techniques to find this inner silence, but I think it's important to remember that this inner silence is there always waiting for you to explore it. And this inner silence is about getting to know yourself again, as you mentioned earlier, Will, because silence is about yourself, silence is about who you are, and noise is all about living through other people, is all about running away from yourself, and it's all about forgetting who you are. But when I read about you, Will, I got fascinated that you already 15-year-old went on your first expedition. I didn't know about it, so it's quite different from walking to the North Pole. Do you mind just say a few words about the expedition and what drove you originally into keep on exploring when you were 15 years old by yourself or with some friends?
Yeah, I mean, I was in, I have, like you say, children have this inspiration to explore, and I had that. I was not unusual. I was an average kid. I made a life out of it because that's what I wanted to do. But most kids have three TV channels, and they're all pretty boring. But there's a National Geographic magazine, and the libraries are, if you're lucky, in your house. And that's the pictures of the Geographic I wrapped my dreams around the photographs. So that was my real true inspiration. My first book that I read was Huck Finn when I was a kid. I was left-handed. I'm dyslexic. I have a hard time reading. So picking up this big book, it's illustrated by Huck Finn, was quite a challenge for me, but I couldn't put that thing down. And it was The Adventure of the River. That book actually, I live in, the Minneapolis, St. Paul. You have the Mississippi River that straddles the two cities here. And as a kid, I was aware of the Mississippi. I was always curious about that river. Huck Finn gave me everything I needed to know. It goes down to New Orleans. I thought, I'm heading that way. So I told my dad when I was 12, I want to go down the Mississippi River to New Orleans. And he said, yeah, you can do it, but you have to have a good boat. I come from a family where we had pretty much all the freedom we wanted, but if we wanted to do something, we had to pay for it. Nobody gave us a check or anything. And we also had to have good grades. A certain type of grade level in order to achieve that freedom. But I took a boat down the Mississippi to New Orleans in 1960. My brother Tom, he was 17. And that was quite a trip. It was my first and last motorized adventure. Because we didn't know anything about budgets, and the gas tank on the motorboat took all our money away. So we had to write home for money, but we had to pay that back. So all the money went in the gas tank, which was good for us because in the towns, we had to hit up the priest or whatever, always looking for a meal. And then being in New Orleans without any money, for 3 weeks, we had a boat to live on, and we met tons of people. That was a good adventure, but I would never do it motorized again. And then I started climbing, and climbing was very important to me because I wanted to be a major climber. And no one climbed in the cities. I checked the book out of the library and bought a hemp rope and started top rope climbing at Taylor's Falls. No one climbed in the 60s. I never saw a climber or a kayaker in the state. And I ended up doing rock climbing, and I did walls when I was 18 while climbing, and it was on that I hit that edge. I mean, I got to a place where I thought I was going to fall and I was going to die. And I was so freaked out. I was on this ledge. I couldn't go back. I couldn't go forward. I picked the wrong route, of course. I calmed down, and for the first time I got into the moment, and it was very peaceful. Suddenly this terror that was around me turned into this incredible, I could smell everything, I could hear the birds, and all my movements were great. My stepping on my foothold was about an inch ledge, and that was plenty of rock to hold you. I was panicking, I thought it wasn't enough, but it was finding that edge. It was that edge where you push to the limit, where you have to be at your total best. You've got to be in that moment. And when I experienced that, I wanted to experience it more and more. That was the teacher I wanted. But in order to experience more, I had to have the discipline to learn the skills so I could push myself more and more. So that's been kind of the story of my life, is to push that edge. And I push that edge in everything I do because there's a frontier, and that's where the learning is. And that's what we're talking about, encouraging people to push their edge. And take that 90-degree turn sometimes in your life. I mean, I see so many peers of mine that retire, and a lot of them are having a good time, but a lot of them they don't have a purpose. And but when you're, especially the older you get, the more you've got to challenge that. So we all have to take a right-hand turn, or don't be discouraged. If society and your parents are telling you can't do that sign. Are being practical means you can do it, and that's very important, because failure is in the isn't. And so if you're not trying, you're not doing it. If you're trying,
I'll just add a few words to what Will said. He said he was dyslexic as a kid and was suffering because of that. I think that's an interesting point, because in my experience is not every explorer, but most explorers, they explore for many reasons, as you started off saying. That's cool, Will. And I'm just catching up, Will, on what you said about being dyslexic. And and in my experience, most explorers, they know about some of the reasons they explore, and they're not aware of others. But I think one thing almost everyone has in common is that they have felt this insecurity early in life. Mm-hmm. And somehow the earlier you have felt it, kind of the better it is, in the sense that it shapes you later. Of course, it can be traumatic. But in my case, if I had grown up, felt confident at school, and had a great life, and all the girls want to kiss me when I was 13 or 16 or 17 years old, I don't think I walked to the North Pole. Of course, this is to simplify, but one of the reasons I went to the North Pole, Everest, South Pole, etc., is because I didn't have a super tough childhood, but I didn't learn how to say my own name before I was 10 years old. I didn't learn how to read before I was 10 years old, because I also was dyslexic. And although I don't feel it's, I've done it out of revenge, but still, like, you know, you get this inner drive in you that you don't get if your life has been too easy. So I don't want to romanticize about being harassed at school and I was the worst pupil in class 12 years in a row, or at least bottom three. In one way it was tough, but I never or hardly ever seen any other people I went to school with afterwards. So I think it also was a good education for me.
Yeah, very good point. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I think it's
Please, Will. Oh yeah. I mean, your story is similar to mine. I mean, I had a tough time getting through school, and you know, you didn't get a date real fast when you're dyslexic and can't read properly. But I also, as a kid, I saw that was good for me. I had to work harder, and my parents set a goal. I had to have 79%. That was a C+. You know, B's were not, you know, B's were like a super A+ for me, but so, you know, so it's like anything, you know, I had the discipline, and without that, Ann Bancroft is a great friend of mine. Ann is dyslexic and against all odds.
Well, and I have to say, Ann is a great girl, and also Brent Bodde, your partner to the North Pole, he helped us a lot when we walked to the North Pole. So whenever you're in touch with him, please give him my regards. Great guy.
Yeah,
but just we have 3 minutes left. Just out of curiosity, I remember when I read your book in '87. I read it as a textbook. Bergen, we read it as a textbook, because you know, to learn, you know, learn all the tricks. But you were very much into Robert Perry. I don't think the question is super important, but interesting, because you were so involved in it. Do you think he made it to the North Pole or not?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I read everything, you know, of course, but I felt I had to do it unsupported. Sexton only exactly how, you know, he did it without any you know, backup or whatever. But yes, I really feel, I feel Perry did exactly what he said he did within the era of his instruments. He probably got within 5 miles of the pole. He did take a sounding, and that sounding went down to 11,000 feet and the line broke. And then I studied the, you know, the depth of the ocean, but right close to the pole, you know, it drops down to the abyss. It drops down the Loma South Ridge. And the only place where he could have got that sounding from Ellesmere all the way up was at, you know, 89.28 minutes. So he was close on that sounding, showed where he was, but he could do exactly what he did in mileage. Everything that he was physically possible. The navigation was the question, but we got within, you know, a mile of the pole, 100 yards of the pole. And because of Paul Shirky, he was a great navigator. So I think historically, I think Perry got the bad end of the stick. But I think, you know, it's always interesting, polar explorers. And as you know, there's a lot of people that say they did stuff and actually never did. It's filled with all sorts of wrong type of stories and that, but it's a fascinating world.
Yeah, I think it's with Toffen and Laura, and I think it's like to be an explorer today, North Pole explorer today, is of course super different from how it was when Peary and all these other great guys, Nansen, Amundsen, Scott Shackleton, Kane, etc., did their stuff. But I think still, the similarities are great. And I think the toughest thing, I think, on a polar expedition, you can say you think is the toughest, Will. I think the toughest thing on a North Pole expedition is to get up in the morning at the right time every day. And that's just as tough today as it was 100 years ago. That's my experience. What is the toughest for you, Will?
Well, you know, we always... the explorers like you're talking about, Scott, the guide, and Amundsen and all that, we always felt they had the advantage over us. Because we had logistics, but they had the unknown. They were actually exploring. They didn't know what was ahead. And I couldn't think of anything better than that type of situation. And I've been in similar, but not, you know, wasn't in that era. So to have something that's totally explored and you explored is something.
I have to add a final note. I think that's a very good point, because the original North Pole, South Pole explorers, they went into the unknown. But then you read the history of exploration, more or less every explorer, sailing the oceans or whatever they have done, or going on to across the plains, beyond the mountains, they have met people. There's always someone standing on the beach waving when Western explorers discovered a new land or new island. So history of exploration is mostly about rediscoveries, while the North Pole and the South Pole is about really proper exploration.
Yeah, and exploring hasn't changed in the fact that even today, regardless of what you're exploring, it can be on the computer, you're still exploring, and you're exploring yourself. We continually to explore our mind. And itself, and that's the spirit. That's where the spirit is. And
we are born explorers, and I think it's all about finding your own North Pole. So just get out. That's good advice for your charge from Norway.
Yeah, I think we're out of being muted here. I think we're at the end. Listen, this connect. I want to connect with you in Norway, and I'm going to text you.
Are you coming to Norway kind of this year, next year?
Not this year, but it could be a situation with the presentation.
You know, I'd like to email you also, just to, you know, have a few questions, if that's okay with you, about the North Pole. So you know, it's just some background. Maybe I quote you in my book on the North Pole. It will be a kind of a memoir about the North Pole. So it's a little bit about me, but mostly about the history of the world.
Yeah. Sorry, I've got a cookbook out. I'll send that to you too.
Yes, sir.
great conversation here. I got balloons flying up in my screen. I don't know what that means.
But it was really great to catch up, Will. I will say hello to Berge from you.
Yeah.
If you see Anne or Richard Weber or Brent, please give them my regards and give them a hug.
Okay, good. Yeah. Sorry, my technology failed me there for a minute, but nothing new. Okay, catch you later. See you guys.
Super duper, Will. Bye bye.
Hasta la vista.